Amen. Thank you, Pastor Tremaine, and all of those who are here tonight. You can see that the interesting dialogue and discussion was going forth. We're grateful for another opportunity today to come together. I'm just praying and hoping that the body of Christ is gaining something personal. I was going to make a comment a few minutes ago. One of the disservice I think that we picked up along the way is this disservice by the body of Christ is always looking at everybody else and paying a little attention, looking at themselves. We have been conditioned and kind of maneuvered in the way of ministry to always look at what is not right. And when we need to be paying attention to how long God been trying to get me to act right, how long God been trying to get me, and when I focus on myself, that's one less headache in the world. That's one less problem in the world. And I believe this is why we see more one-on-one ministry today, that God is dealing with this particular person, i.e. me, just the same way he's dealing with your life. And when we begin to mature and grow in that, we become better as a whole. So we're going to have some exciting things to present tonight. This has just been an empowering study for me. I'm learning some things as I go along, Pastor Tree. I'm going to pray. And if you'll just give us a brief overview, because you ended last week where we were. And I want to point out a few things that came to my heart this morning. In reference to this excellence in collaborating in ministry as leaders. Heavenly Father, had it not been for you, we would not be here this evening. And we owe you praise, and we really appreciate giving us the energy and walking with us through the day and bringing us to this place. Now be with us tonight, God. We are open to receive and hear. We pray that your word will find a lodging place in us, that we will be more empowered, God, and more determined to do what you called us to do, gifted us to do, anointed us to do. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good evening, everybody. It's good to see everybody. We are 8 weeks tonight into the series Collaborating for Excellence for Ministry, and I just believe the more we do, the more we realize we have to cover, and God is just going to truly bless us. And I'm excited for the study tonight as we continue to remember to focus. Why are we here? We're here to be effective. We're here we can be efficient in ministry. We're here to challenge. That's what we were talking about before we joined at live at 7:30, to challenge our theology and our doctrine, and really to see God beyond just what we've been accustomed to and how he operates, right? And so we know we've been dealing with this idea of God picking up, making communication, making contact with us. He calls us, right? He connects with us. He uses people. He uses situations. He uses dreams and visions and all of these things. He uses his word, right? I'm just trying to go, he uses the Holy Spirit. He uses his audible voice. He uses all of these ways to connect, to talk to us, right? So that in that conversation, he might give us an assignment. He might give us a task, or what we have come to know in the body of Christ as a calling. But as we've been moving over the last couple of sessions, we have really begun to hone in on this idea of calling from a tasking and an assignment perspective, and not so much a person or a title or a position, because we found that that limits our thinking to just thinking about being saved. When the reality is, God is bigger than just the saved folk. He's bigger than just the lost folk. He's just so big that he can give callings, he can assign, he can task whoever he wants to. So we've been digging into that. And we started by dealing with what we call the fivefold callings, the fivefold ministry. And tonight we're going to dig a little bit deeper into that and just try to show it at work. But as we prepare to do that, remember that we shared that we're looking at things from a tasking or an assignment perspective. So we want to do our best as we're dealing, and even Bishop and I are challenged that as we're going through the word and we're being mindful of our language, that we don't confuse only even ourselves, because we want to focus in on the tasking and the assignment of God, right? We even, I think, from most of our, even changed and dropped maybe calling a little bit to really hone in on tasking, assignment. That's what the calling is really doing. And so as we're doing that, remember God graces us, he gifts us, He anoints us to be able to fill whatever the assignment is. He gives us all kinds, we know scripture, all kinds of gifts in the body that we might be able to fulfill the assignments and the tasks that is on our lives. And last week we ended, Bishop, with talking about this understanding of mission and the vision of God, or the kingdom agenda of God, right? That overpowering agenda of God, that no matter what the individual callings and assignments and tasks God gives, it is so that he can achieve his kingdom agenda. There's many ways of looking at it, but I'm going to boil it down. He wants to help people be better. That is his kingdom agenda.
Yeah, and before I jump in tonight, you again, it's critical that we understand words that we use.
Yes.
And you mentioned kingdom. We need to explain that. That wasn't a part of our study. So when we talk about kingdom agenda, it goes beyond just want to help folk. It's a king over everything.
Right.
And God, the Lord is over everything. He is king, big K with a little K, King of Kings.
Right.
It's his operation, just like the government of the United States. It's not a kingdom. It's a governing body functioning for the United States. And then you got Korea, South Korea, North
right.
Korea. All of these are different operations. But there is this understanding that God's kingdom supersedes all of that, and it's made up of men and women, every race, creed, and color, age, you name it, and he is operating it and controlling it.
Right. I think the example that we used on last week as we dug into that idea of kingdom was that I've learned that I had to drop so much the word church, because it only caused me to look at the believer as the church. Right. And then I begin to really understand what God meant by kingdom, and the vision and the analogy he gave is that if you go back to history in school and you pick any country that you want that had a king, they may have had a king, they may have had a queen, they may have had some princes and a prince and a princess, and then they had servants, and then they had the people that were out and all of that, that all of that made a kingdom, not one person. So when we look at God, God has so graced, as Bishop said, the entire world is the kingdom of God. Race, creed, color, denomination, not denominations, the Cains, the Ains, the wannabes, everybody is a part of God's kingdom. So when we talk about his kingdom agenda, we're talking about how is God engaging with those that he is king over, right? How is he engaging us?
And with that idea, how he engages, is the king's responsibility to take care of his citizens.
Yes, absolutely.
That's the idea. Not us taking care of him. His responsibility, this is my kingdom. I got to function my kingdom in a way that everybody be taken care of, not the ones that I like. That's the fallacy that we have
right.
in the government that we have. We got parties and we got all of these things going on, and it depends on what party you are and how you be taken care of. And then those who really need help gonna drop through the crack. But in the kingdom, the king is responsible for every one of his citizens.
And
so
how,
that's a concept.
And how he does that is through the callings and the assignments
right.
and the tasks that he gives all of those a part of the kingdom, so that we can work together, if y'all remember last week, as a ball, working together. So that means all of us have to have an assignment by God, given by God, that we can work the kingdom agenda, which is really the betterment of all mankind.
So we're going to get into that, but that is a good example
right.
of us understanding how much we have been indoctrinated with, down through experiences, through our own teaching in school, that we function in the way the United States has conditioned us to function as a government versus the way God wants us to function as his citizens of his kingdom. That makes sense? We're supposed to trust the king and believe in the king and know that the king have our best interests at heart. Okay, and we can go through the scriptures and look at things like David and others running the kingdom. Why was Saul so great for a period of time, but then why did Saul fail? He got his eyes off of God and he began to look at Saul.
And Bishop, you know what's funny, and I know we're going to move, I just thought about this, maybe it's for our personal study, not so much where did we get off track, but there was a time when the king, capital K, was over what we would consider government, if you will, right? We got it printed on our money. The Constitution breaks it up. But at the end of the day, where do we lose that respect, if you will, that reverence, that responsibility, understanding that it's not just one person, one group, one party, one race, one creed that makes up the kingdom of God. But yet we I thought about this when you said that, but yet we still pray before every congressional session as he is the king. Oh, God, grace us or whatever. But then we go down underneath of that, and how do we handle it? So I just thought I'd throw that out because it's something that challenged me. I said, "Where? Why do we? There was a time when he was seen as that." And, you know, not saying that we don't see him as that, but even in the church.
So we are presenting this from a kingdom perspective and not from a governmental perspective or our former teaching in school. If you guys would go back and let's look at our foundation scripture, we're going to focus really on one in 1 Corinthians. If you could get that, Pastor Tree. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 13, that's one of the foundational scriptures. And it says that he gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teaching. And the reason he gave them is for perfecting of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, into a perfect man, unto the measure and stature of the fullness. I just want to pull that out so we can see the fivefold. And we don't, when we start talking about that, because they are titles, that's what we zoom into. And when Pastor Tree read 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 27, he says first, so the flesh always want to be better than someone else. So when he says first apostle, everybody want to be apostle. Then Nate, second prophets, then evangelists, and so forth. So we done line them up, who's greater, superiority, and all of that. And no longer is it a unit rolling along, getting accomplished what God want. If you go to Ezekiel, whenever you're doing your study, Ezekiel had a vision, and he said he saw this move in the kingdom in this vision. It was a wheel in the middle of a wheel. And he said it neither turned any way. It just went. It's kind of like a ball rolling down. If it goes left, it don't have to change. It just moves. And that's the way the body of Christ, we should be supposed to be flowing together. But I really want to, as Pastor Tremaine mentioned, is focus in on the task and not the title. I'm not so much concerned about the apostle prophet. I'm concerned about what God tasked them to do. And that's where I want us to begin to examine our lives. What has God tasked me? So I want to use 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 27, because it actually gives 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Right.
And I want to use that in our discussion tonight to try to get us to begin to see and focus in on the task and not on the title.
Right. So we know the Word of God says don't add to it or take it away. So we're reading the Word of God the way God intended, we believe, for it to be read. But now we're going to dig down to. So when you hear the fivefold, don't think about the title. Think about what they're going to be tasked to do.
We told everybody several weeks ago what, in a very basic term, the assignment that comes with being an apostle, the assignment that comes with being a prophet. And we will touch on that a little bit as we move forward just to refresh us. So let's focus in on the text.
So let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, right at verse number 27. And pray the Lord to grace it this way. He says, now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. And God has placed in the church, first of all, apostles, setting order. Second, prophets. Third, teachers. Then miracles. Then gifts of healing, of guidance, and of different kinds of tongue. All are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, do all work miracles, do all have gifts of healing, do all speak in tongues, do all interpret. Now eagerly desire the greater gifts.
So now, if you can drop the title and think about when he gave first this task, and we've mentioned to you that apostle in the very basic way is to set order. Okay? So, Pastor Tree, focusing in on this gift, if he first gave apostles or first gave the task of setting order, there must have been some disorder. There must have been some division. You have to have order before you can do anything else. So he first gave the gifting or the assignment to set some order, okay? And we're going to touch on this to make it clear. Before you're going to have peace in your home, joy in your home, there need to be some order. There need to be some apostolic calling on whoever is in the house.
Responsible.
Somebody got to step up, okay? So now this is why I wanted to look at the task and not the title, because flesh want to run to the title and not paying attention that every position, there's a responsibility to come with being a mom, responsibility to come with being a dad, responsibility to come on your job or whatever title you have. But we are not so much focused on the responsibility or the assignment. We are focused on I'm making this amount of money and this who I am.
Bishop, can I add to that? Because you used the home, and we're focusing in on that idea of setting order. God does that first, right? So we think about, Bishop used that example, and let's just think of the world in general. In order for anything else to function, there must be some order. So God gives assignments out throughout the world that individuals are given the grace and the gifting with the assignment of setting order. There's order in many. There's order in the school. There's order in the Walmart. There's order, and there are people that are gifted and graced to set order. Why? So there is not chaos. So before we can, I'm going to say this nicely, before we can expect just for there to be change in certain things, there must be some order set. However, and whoever has that assignment, right, if it's not my assignment to set the order, I'm not doing God a service, I'm doing him a disservice. So sometimes our passion for things to be better, we move outside of our assignment,
right,
and we affect the overall kingdom agenda of God.
And the reason we move outside of it is because we went to school and got educated.
Right.
Because we made ourselves successful in this field, but not in this one. So we think it all work anywhere. Remember now when Pastor Tremaine was reading 12, it says first apostle, prophet, and so forth. And he says all of them are empowered by the Holy Spirit. All of them. It's for the work of ministry, all of them. So I hope we get that. So now the task or the work assignment that's given unto the individual that God knows, the Holy Spirit now comes in to work in and through that individual. So now if I am gifted by God and tasked by God to do this, I'm going to have to do it. Mm-hmm. You with me? John can't do what God tests me to do. But if I'm here bother so much about what John and Sally not doing, I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do. That it makes sense. So the Spirit now graces all of us and each of these fivefold that we're talking about, give them particular assignment. Now the reason that the Spirit does this,
mm-hmm.
order, okay? The Holy Spirit want to keep unity.
Mm-hmm.
The Holy Spirit want to empower us to achieve, and then the Holy Spirit going to lead us to get there. So we got to have the Holy Spirit along with the grace and the anointing that God give us so we can accomplish the task. So when in the body, Pastor Tremaine, the flesh again gets involved, and we envy what somebody else is doing as if we're not part of the body.
Right.
And instead of me functioning where I supposed to function, now them causing division because I don't want to do this, I want to do that.
And Bishop, I want to add, because you used the Holy Spirit, right? I said the word, the person, the Holy Spirit. And I want to even give a broader perspective of that, because we are recognizing that the kingdom encompasses everybody, and everybody don't know Holy Spirit. But what is the Holy Spirit? It is an empowerment that is not of oneself. So the empowerment of God, not of oneself, has to come in and give unity, empowerment, leading, and all of that. As we have individuals, again, remember, we're trying to work through this ourselves, keeping in mind the kingdom. Everybody don't know what the Holy Spirit is. But when we say an empowerment that is not of your own doing, not of your own giving, not of your own explanation, but it leads, it empowers, it gives the heart. So at the end of the day, a leader can be empowered and never use the word Holy Spirit.
And a leader can be anybody, whether we like them or not.
Exactly.
It depends on who God set and anointed for that. This is where the body of Christ now need to begin to process. More importantly, we as individuals need to check ourselves. Mm-hmm. So we remember now, gifts are given to the body. Individual who God has grace are given to the body to perfect the saints. We just read that. And we perfect in them for work of ministry, for it to be one task going on. Mm-hmm. Not only that, gifted individual, men and women, are gifted by God for these particular or specific assignment. So this is why we need to know those who labor among us, not by title, but why have some of these individuals joined UFCM in this season? Why not 10 years ago? Why didn't God hold them up in next? There, he's the one that sets in the body. And when we wake up to that, it's not how long you've been on church roll. Mm-hmm. Or how much money you give, God knows what he's doing. So we got to be open to that. In addition to that, the fivefold gift can be better understood if we look at the task, and that's our focus rather than the title. I don't know what is it about human nature, got to have a title. I don't know. Matter of fact, I'm trying to lose mine.
Or position.
Because it makes folk feel less damn when you're, I'm Dr. So-and-co. What? No, Negro, you just like me. Come on back down here and get your feet on the ground. You breathe and eat, and you put your pants on just like me. Let's reason together so we can get the work of God done. You with me? And I found out, Pastor Tremaine, people who like to push title, they ain't got a whole lot going on.
They don't.
They really don't.
But the title.
Yeah, but the title. So now, as a team, God, and it's more than the five, but let's say he put this five in the group together. Mm-hmm. Said, I'm going to put you here. Somebody's there to set order. Somebody there is to confirm an apostle, a prophet, remember, in the basic term, normally talk to leaders, and he hears from God, and he's speaking to the leader, whoever the leader is, and then either correcting or bringing some confirmation. In the very simple term, then you got the evangelist that God kind of sends out in van to prepare people to be brought in. Mm-hmm. And then it's no use having a pastor if you ain't got no sheep to watch over. This is why I want us to begin to look at the task. And it's no use having a pastor watch over people when you got chaos. So the first thing he sent or set or task was order.
And I'm going to go and I'm going to add to that because Bishop used that example. There's no point in having a teacher in the school if there's not a principal. And a principal if there's not administrators. And administrators if there's not a school board. The order got to be set so that one can go out and confirm and then one can do the encouragement and acknowledgement and the teaching. So it don't matter where you put it, there's still going to have to be some order and some understanding of how those 5, 6, 10, 20, whatever millions of assignments work together, though we're focusing in tonight to understand because he said first. So that means there are some that are required in order for all of these others to work together through the gifting of God. So he sets everybody there. God sets everybody there as a unit, as a team to win, to accomplish the task and the assignments that he's given each of us to do. But overall, it's to accomplish his kingdom agenda, right? So the point is to win. So when we talk about winning, what does that mean? His desire is for this unit, this team, this group of assigned, called, tasked individuals to be victorious, to triumph, to succeed, to achieve whatever those things are that he wants us to, that he said. And we know what are we supposed to be victorious, triumph, and achieve? One, we know is to win souls, right? One is to win the battle between good.
Okay, let me win soul mean add to the body,
right?
And so we be taking over the kingdom and not losing from the body.
And Bishop, I'm gonna even add to that because we've been having some dialogue before 6:30. When we say souls to the kingdom, souls to Christ, my sister has this belief that our assignment is to get people one step closer. Everybody ain't gonna come in all at once and lie out in the floor and speak in tongues. So sometimes our assignment to win souls for Christ is not just a one-time thing. It might be an ongoing process. What did Paul say? One plant, one water, God get the increase. But we try and do it all at one time. So winning souls is just not that easy.
Yeah. Just, we're doing such a poor job because we've been conditioned to walk on through the Romans road to salvation and get them to say the right thing. Yeah, I believe in Jesus
Christ. But they got no conviction.
And then we put them in water, you saved. No, we done a very poor job. best simplistic. It's easy on us. I don't take a whole lot of time. When am I going to have interest in you starting this journey and continuing in it?
Win souls for Christ is not just the salvation of eternal life either. Sometimes he wants us to win souls for him that they don't starve to death on the street.
So now let's make this live.
Okay.
I'm an object learner. I learn visually. And we have talked about gift and titles, and we go over and over and over, and we done beat that horse, but there's something going on among us. We still ain't getting it. So I got it with this morning, say, hey, we got to put the picture out there and let them see it. So now if you go to the book of Acts, chapter 1, we know about the Holy Spirit coming in like a dove. We know all that, and we shout, and we do all that jumping. So I just said that he first gave the task to set order.
There we go. Yeah.
Okay. Now watch this.
I'll read and you can stop. So Acts chapter 1, let's start there. Remember, he said first the tasking of setting order. He says, in my former book, Theophilus, I'm in Acts chapter 1, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up into heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles.
You got it. Now, y'all set make sure you got, y'all see that. When chapter 1, this is before the church really got kicked off.
Before the Holy Spirit.
The apostles are there. It's 12 of them. Well, 11 of them.
Right, 11.
Okay, 11 of them. Okay.
Giving instructions through the Holy Spirit, they go to Spirit guiding, to the apostles, if y'all give me liberty, to the set order, the assignment to set order, task to set order, he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. And I won't say this, Bishop, because I know you're going to go. He said kingdom of God and not church. So remember when we say kingdom, what we're talking about.
Okay. So what I wanted to pick up is because we got the title apostle, and we know Paul said first, and we're going to hit that in a few minutes. I would suggest a way for us to deprogram ourselves and see the context of this is the crucifixion has taken place.
Right.
And it's 40 days before this, they saw all of this gory, bleeding, cheering. You know the crucifixion story. People from everywhere, and we're going to get in those names in a few minutes, came from everywhere. They have witnessed this. There is chaos and disorder around the world. They're in Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. So now, here in Acts, after the writer says, after 40 days after Jesus was crucified, the disciples are scared. They are confused. People from every different city and town throughout the known world at that time are now in Jerusalem. They have witnessed this horrible event. There is disorder. There is no order. So now here comes the apostles to set some order after this mess. Mm. It's the one that he chose, and he showed himself to many different ways over 40 days.
And Bishop, in that 3-4 right in there, he said he presented himself to them, giving them convincing proof. In other words, he is calling them.
Right.
He's talking to them, and he's giving them this assignment of how they're going to set order.
In the midst of confusion, chaos, I have died,
fear,
resurrected, and I showed myself to you. Now, jokers, this is what I call y'all to do, set some order in this mess. Mm-hmm. Are y'all seeing it? Okay, so when we see a church that's all over the place, there needs to be some order before we go further.
And as we're going through, remember some of the things we said about what must be present, the Holy Spirit and God calling and talking to you and giving you something. So as we go to verse number 4, he's beginning to talk to them about this set in order, this assignment. It says, on one occasion, verse 4, while he was eating with them, he gave them a command. He gave them some instructions. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift, the gracing, the empowerment, the anointing my Father promised, which you heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and asked, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said, it is not for you to know the times or the dates. Don't worry about all of that. That God Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power. power, I'm adding so we can understand, gracing, you're going to receive anointing, you're going to receive a gifting when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be witnesses. You will know without a shadow of a doubt that I have put my hands on you to set order. I'm trying to make it live. Set order in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria to the ends of the earth. He said.
Here are these individuals, 11 of them, that God is speaking to them. He's calling them. He's giving them an assignment. And he tells them, you're going to need the Holy Spirit and wait on him.
Don't move.
We cannot do anything about it. And again, I'm just wanting us to look at the task that he's given an apostle. So in this waiting and in following the direction, if we just pause, what if we was in a group and I didn't like that? But if we go back some weeks earlier, remember Peter decided to go back fishing. He had to go get him and said, no, I call you out of that to this. Remember, he talked to all the other leaders to go fishing. Are y'all with me? Not only that, they witnessed one of their own in the midst called part of this chaos and destruction. Y'all with
me? It goes on way. Yeah.
But I have chosen you guys to set order in the midst of this. And you're going to do it if you wait on the Holy Spirit. Again, we got to hear and we got to allow the Spirit to come and be involved and not wait on somebody to come and assign us, task us, and tell us we need to know.
Bishop,
now, neither one of these, every one of those guys that hearing it should be able to articulate this.
Absolutely. And the other thing that I wanted to point out, I just love verses 4 through 8, and I'm putting it in language I understand. You're not going to be able to do the assignment that I'm giving you to do until you're empowered by the Holy Spirit. Going
you
back to that, you need
it. You ain't going to get the Holy Spirit unless you wait on it.
So it's not.
Because it's going to be not many days from now. So I'm going to see if you're going to wait
right.
and do what I
the
tell you.
The process of not just getting up, oh, I got a calling on my life and I run. I got to wait till God gives me. Now it's time. You have been empowered. You've been equipped. You've been grace gifted, however we want to say it, to now go and do this particular task for them, which is setting order.
Okay, now understand that's all happening in the midst of chaotic society, confused, divided society, before the Holy Spirit came.
Mm-hmm.
He gave
He told them to wait on it first.
Now watch this in verse 12 through 14.
It says, then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives. At Sabbath's day, a Sabbath day walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present, very important, Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James.
Y'all get that? I think it's 11 of them.
Right. Not Judas Iscariot, Judas the son of James. And they all joined together constantly in prayer, along with women and Mary and the mother of Jesus was, and with his brothers.
Okay. So now I wanted you to see they had already gotten instruction, gotten their task, their assignment in the midst of this chaotic. In one place, there's 11 of them. Read, I'll keep pointing out 11. They need to now follow.
Mm-hmm.
There is an anointing and a grace that God give to a leader. Mm-hmm. Now, when we look at verse 15, it says, and in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, the number of the names together were about 120. Men and brethren, the writer just put that note in there. Peter stood up and said, men and brethren, this scripture must need be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit by the mouth of David spoke before concerning Judah, which was God to them that took Jesus. And he goes on to tell them, and he was numbered with us and what had transpired.
Mm-hmm.
What I want to point out there is the Holy Spirit hadn't come yet. But he using scripture to support his grace of God to bring order. So before we can go out and do what God, there need to be an order. And matter of fact, God had 12, and it's critical that we have these 12 because the scripture says here, so out of the grace that God had given unto Peter, Peter now is telling them, setting order among the 11. That making sense?
And Bishop, I wanted to, you just hit on it. The scripture says there were 11 that were assigned to set order. But in this moment, only one had the grace of God in that moment to begin to set it. They weren't arguing about, well, wait a minute, we all supposed to be doing it. How you going to talk?
Well, what if they wasn't on one accord, right, and James stood up, been out of order? He wasn't graced to do that. And I began to think about the Lord telling Judah, telling Peter, upon this rock I build my church. Upon the fact that you can discern and get revelation from heaven, you got an anointing on you that these other jokers don't have. But Peter needs to know this. It ain't about a job that I want to do and I'm better than it. You remember there were two brothers, one wanted to sit on the right, one on the left. They're in this group. So the point is, when are we going to take ownership? Now, Peter is it ain't going to be too long. He's going to get jacked up again. But the point is, you can't take away the grace and the anointing and the authority that the Lord placed on him. So he stands in the midst of the other 11. The other 10, and he makes this declaration, and nobody is complaining because they got an assignment.
And then I'm going to make sure that we got the full context when Bishop mentioned Peter. Jesus said to Peter, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but such is the Son of Man, right? So in other words, God himself, Peter, had to give you that gracing, that anointing. You ain't talking out of yourself. You have a gift in you, and of course Peter don't know how that gift is going to unfold on this day. And it what I like about when you read the scripture, it doesn't show any discord, it doesn't show any hesitation. It just says Peter stood up and began to talk.
But when we can go back and also look at Peter's life, you remember Peter's way of doing it, cutting people's ears off,
right?
Peter's way of doing it, no, forbid this from you, Lord. And the Lord said, do you love me? So he had to go through this training and anointing to get what he had. And now he has gone through all of this chaos, and he takes on this responsibility under the grace of God to get his brethren together so now we can accomplish the task. Okay. So he stood up in the midst of the disciples and in the midst of all that was going on around them, and he individually began to speak that this group of men come together. Okay, it has nothing to do with your title, how long you've been walking with Jesus Christ. It has to do with your anointing that you have on your life to speak at the proper time, be quiet at the proper time. Okay, we good there? Now let's look at verse 16.
16, and with the payment he received for his wickedness, talking about Judas, Judas bought a field. There he fell headlong, his body burst open, and all of his intestines spilled out. And everyone in Jerusalem heard about this, so they called to the field in their language that this is the field of blood. Four said, Peter, it is written in the book of Psalms, may his place be deserted, like let there be no one left to dwell in it, and may another take the place of his leadership.
So and establishing order. Why this vacant position by Judas need to be filled. And he's using scripture to do it. Not that he just want to do it. He is being led by the Spirit to fill that position. And as a result, Peter talking, these individuals now put out two names. And I want you to hear, if you don't mind, Tremaine, reading what their qualifications
are. So verse 21 says, therefore it is necessary to choose one of the men who have been with us the whole time. The Lord Jesus was living among us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. So they nominated two men, Joseph, called Barsabas, also known as Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed, Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two you have chosen to take over the apostolic apostle setting order ministry, which Judas left to go where he belongs. Then they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias, so they added to the 11 apostles.
So now again, to his grace to bring order among the people in the work, and he's speaking, he's led to make these recommendations. There's still calmness, unity, and it's coming together. Notice the Holy Spirit still hadn't fell on them. But notice how he is bringing them together by Scripture, not his ideology. And he's going to the Scripture, bringing it before them that they might be aware. And the lot fell on Mathis. Okay, so now they got the 12. 12 in the number of scripture represent governing.
Order.
So now that's order, and now there is the governance established. Y'all ought to know what happened next. The Holy Spirit came in. You see what I'm saying? But if I already done went to school and I already know how to be the secretary, the administrator, the song, the soloist, and all of that, and nobody else can do this for me, that's a one-man show, and that is not of the Lord.
And what's so powerful about this scripture and this teaching is when we know the Holy Spirit is in it, but how God confirms what he said over in 1 Corinthians 12 and Ephesians, first the apostles, and now we're watching him put this into motion. It's not just word. Now he's putting it in motion. Okay, first, I'm gone. There's a lot of chaos. Let me send the apostles. Let me walk them through why they got to set order. Not just why they got to set order. We need 12. Why God picked 12 number of government. But most importantly, God says, I have 12 appointed set in order people. I need 12. I can't worry about the one. I gift as I want. Now, y'all, to talk about it. And he sets, again, back to the 12. So I like the way that God uses his word to confirm his word as he's going through. And now we're seeing not just a scripture we pull, first kings, first apostles, then prophets, then evangelists. But no, now we're seeing God said, let me give you some practical understanding of where I work this at, so there is no confusions. And that's where we end up in Acts 1 and over in Acts 2, the actual unveiling right. of this.
And he didn't get the teachers in there before he set some order. He didn't bring the pastors on the scene before you set order. Order had to be there first. Mm-hmm. And the Holy Spirit had to be among and on them first. But there was this grace and assignment given unto all of the apostles. But Peter had that anointing to be bold enough to stand up and lead some information out there. And everybody joined in. So okay, now that happened, I want to look at chapter 2. And this is critical because it's still order. Titles, but God set order first in the midst of the community being confused, they being confused. It's confusion, division inside and outside. Mm-hmm. But I'm bringing order now first to the ones I have chosen so they can set order in matters.
And so we're going to be in chapter 2 of Acts 1 through 13, and we're going to kind of bounce down through that. It says, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place, and suddenly, like the blowing of a violent wind, came from heaven, and they filled the whole house that they were sitting in. And they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Let me just real quick, as the Spirit enabled them, as the Spirit empowered them, as the Spirit gifted them. It says, now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven.
Well, y'all don't underline that. This is going on the outside. The mm-hmm. people on the outside are confused. If there's confusion, first there need to be order. So mm-hmm. now they're confused. The Holy Spirit come upon them, and they got even more confused.
Right.
Remember, they witnessed the crucifixion and all that, and they're away from their home because this is only 50 days after mm-hmm. the resurrection. That making sense? Okay, just I want y'all to understand the testing and what is going on the outside. So we seen the order being brought among the apostles themselves, and now the Holy Spirit is coming in to anoint them, so now they can deal with the chaos on the outside.
Right. And it says, now we're seeing in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. And when they heard the sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, in confusion, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they ask, aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? And this is, then how is it that each of us hear them in our native tongue? Parths and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia and Judea and Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia, Pergama and Philippi, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Crene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, They asked each other, what does this mean?
And then there was another group mocking, laughing, thinking they drunk. Okay? Now, who the apostle stood up? Peter. He stood up to set some order in the midst of chaos. And that started in verse number 14.
Hey, Bishop, before you go there, and I want to say, because I think we're bringing the point home about assignment and tasking. But I also want to remember one of our things is to keep destroying these myths. I say this, Bishop said, who stood up? Peter. Please understand, that did not belittle any of the other apostles. They're in agreement, but they also are being moved by the Spirit. It's not our time to stand up. This is for Peter, and they're walking together. Don't nobody get up and walk out. Don't nobody get no attitude. They're all flowing in this assignment because what? They know they got an assignment too. And so they're not prematurely moving because they say, I got a calling from God. I got a calling from God. He called me, called me, called me. They're not prematurely moving. They're waiting on the direction of God to when, to where, to how to go about that assignment. So I thought it was important that we point that out because we're recognizing that Peter is popping up, but Peter is one of 11, but he is the one appointed for this time.
Right, and more than that, he's one of 120.
120, right.
Okay, and it is important that we understand that as well, is that he's one among 120, but the Bible tells us they were praying and during this time of waiting, they are communicating. The other thing the Bible pointed out, they were on one accord, and meaning there's no confusion among that 120. Understand this, when the Holy Spirit came in, they left the building and went outdoors to set some order, not the disciples, all of them. So now you can see some teachers, and now you can see some evangelists that God is allowed going outside this building.
Bishop, you know something, and I'm going to throw this out. The scripture doesn't say this, but when he talked about the agreement, the order, the one accordness, there are a crowd of people that Peter is addressing, right? There's a crowd. I want you to look at it. He's addressing a crowd of people. Just because Peter says it doesn't mean they get it. But the others are walking together in agreement with what Peter said. Peter, we know what the assignment is right now to set order. So they're not only there as observers, if you will, but they're also there as partners with what Peter has been assigned to do. And they are also saying, did you hear what Peter said?
But not only that, they're there as an interpreter.
Right.
For how we understand these guys in our own language. The Holy Spirit has graced them to be able to speak to these individuals so they can understand. So you can see it all flowing and rolling together, and nobody's trying to be anything but what God gifted them or tasked them to do. This is why I want us to see how it actually flows and work. So now the 12 came into order, and the 120 came into order that they are one. So now when the Holy Spirit fell, and I will pause him, put a big pin. Whenever there's going to be a great move of God, the Holy Spirit and much prayer got to take place. We got to have prayer as a part of our life. I remember when we were going through some training here a few weeks ago, an individual by the name of Bob with Bill Graham, he said since they've been moving around the country, one of the things that they sadly see is there's very little prayer among the body of Christ now. But they were praying and on one accord and fasting. In other words, Lord, we desire to hear from you when all of a sudden. But the Holy Spirit didn't come in there just for them to grace upon themselves and brag. They went out and went to work.
Bishop, can I expound on that a little bit? Because that is so, so very key. We're talking about the kingdom. And the kingdom got all walks of life in it, right? So when he says prayer, who's supposed to be praying? Do I need to be in Texas to pray? No. So now I'm praying that God have your way, have your provision. And then Bishop says when there is praying, now we talk about the whole, there is this empowerment that must fall. I don't have to be in a specific location to come into prayer because we recognize that prayer is the language of those that know speaking to a God they believe in on behalf of not themselves, just themselves, but the entire kingdom. So if the kingdom if the United States, if the world, if Texas, if China need God, our job is to pray and let God decide how and when he drops his spirit or his empowerment. And the reason I say that is because the scripture can be a dangerous scripture, especially for believers, because when we see Holy Spirit, we automatically associate it to what? The tongue. It's the empowerment that provoked the tongue. It's the empowerment that provokes whatever God wants to do. So we're not saying that prayer gonna bring tongues necessarily. It's gonna bring an empowerment for God to do whatever he's assigned those individuals he sent to there to do the work. And that's important, and we recognize that.
Right. Now, just back in reverse a little bit, Peter had to get in order.
Right.
The 11 had to get in order.
Yep.
They got the 12 in order. And then 120 got in order. Now they can minister out there.
Mm-hmm.
God forbid us to go try to set somebody else's house in order and ours out of order. That's part of the problem in the body of Christ. When we were talking about the teaching, they can only teach what they know, but the way we have been taught about the Holy Spirit, it limits the Holy Spirit and the anointing and the power that the Holy Spirit would give unto us. Okay, so the Holy Spirit graced them, and now because the house is set in order, all this chaos and confusion that's going on around from every person that had witnessed the crucifixion in Jerusalem, they stand up, and I think verse 13 said they mock them and said that they feel it wine. Interpretation is that they were drunk. So now it says in verse 14, Peter stands up. With the 11, Peter stands up with the support of the 11, and he opens his mouth and he says unto them, ye men of Judea and all ye that dwells in Jerusalem, be it known this day unto you and hearken to my words. I'm getting ready to put some stuff out here to set some order. These men are not drunk as you suppose, seeing it's about the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last day, says God, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men going to have dreams, and your old men, and goes on down the list. So they got to the point where they said, what must we do? See what order will do. Order of God don't bring further confusion. Order and direction from God brings about a peace and brings about direction so we can get this show on the road. That's why God gifted the body.
And I want to back up because I want to make sure, because you said something, it was so pivotal. You said that heaven forbid we go to try to set order somewhere else before we've allowed God to set order with us. Right. I'm coming back to the individual as well, not just the established church. Right. Listen to what I said. How be it for us to go try to set order somewhere else, but we won't let God set order with us, the individual, us, household, us. And I'm just using this for me. I'm not judging. I'm making an observation. Heaven forbid us go to try set order in the Ukraine. And we struggling to set order right here. That don't mean that God didn't grace and tell somebody to go, but we go back to what Bishop said. We don't want to go trying to set order, one, if we're not called to do it. But two, most importantly, if we're doing it of ourselves or because we're operating, and I'm going to use this because I think we can do it, when we're operating out of this place of the goodness and the morality of who God is, but we're not operating out of his power. Y'all with me? It sounds good that we go and set order in the Ukraine. I'm not saying we shouldn't, just stick with me. But if we are not careful, we're operating out of the goodness and the morality of what we know to be good and not out of the calling and the empowerment of God to go do it. Does that see? Y'all understand the difference? So sometimes we put it on God and we make it good and we say, this is what God has told all of us we supposed to do. Go ye therefore into all the world. But wait, God also says, I'm going to call, equip, and send you. So if we're not sent, that can cause confusion for not just us, but the whole world. And I say that because I think sometimes we get in our mind, because we are saved and because we're believers, we get the right to circumvent God in how we choose to move, because it's for the greater good of God. Does that make sense? When that's not how God set it in order to be.
So now he first gave apostle, or better understand, he first gave the task mm-hmm. to bring order. Okay. And then with that direction and order, for what purpose? So my kingdom can be advanced. Okay. The Holy Spirit must be involved for the kingdom of God to advance. The order must be first. What God so set must take place first before mm-hmm. ours. So as you were going through that, it doesn't make sense for us to be out of order here, going somewhere else to set order. It's not that complicated. If you don't have order in your own house, how can you have order in the church and you try to lead it?
And we're not talking about being perfect.
Yeah.
We're talking about the order that God, you're trying to follow the order that God has given you.
Right. So with that being said, the church has lost its power because the church is not in order anymore.
The school has lost its power because the school is not in order, because we want to come off just church, right? Because we say it's the whole kingdom. Our jobs have lost the power because there's no authority. The government, we can just keep going on and on and on and on, because what? We're moving without any order.
So now I liken into the times of where we are right now when we're dealing with COVID, okay? Who has the answer for how we need to move and bring some order in the midst of this?
God.
But have we been really looking at our own wisdom and our own research? And I can't answer for nobody else, but the church is not on its knees. Let the Lord show us the answer.
And Bishop, can I add to that? God is so big that it don't have to look the same everywhere. He can set order, and order still not look the same everywhere, and it not be confusing.
So I raise that there is disorder and confusion, chaos going all around the world. Mm-hmm. And as I got a phone call last week, what the church is doing about it? You know, 3 days ago, we had a shooting in New York, and then yesterday had a shooting in Texas. And I heard one of the sports announcers said, I'm getting tired of this. We pray, and we got a bill sitting on that we can at least be doing something, and you'd rather hold on to your power than to do something about it. Okay? Well, yeah, but I can go a little bit further than that. Where are we as loving one another and listening to one another, embracing one another? Maybe if I listen to you, I might understand that you don't put a 150-page document up that you're going to do some harm. Mm-hmm. But if I am in a rush and I am trying to own and get my own little stuff in order and buy stuff and go, maybe I'm missing the opportunity to minister. Maybe all we need to do now is just slow our roll and listen and love on folks.
Bishop, you know something that you said about the commentator, and I thought about it, and we all know it's true, right? That's just ungodly, right? But I had to check myself and come back to that when he said, you know, we should do something than this, and Bishop used the example of love. Maybe we need to be looking at it this way. And my thought came to my mind is, we're exactly right. We should be doing something. But if God assigned me to do something right here, whatever my lane is, He's also saying, by you doing your assignment, you are doing something. You just don't understand how it come together. But yet, I want to go, well, I need to go over here and do this. Or I need to go over here and do this. God says, wait, just because it's good does not mean it's of God for you to do. What's God for somebody else may just be good for you. Are y'all following me? So I was thinking of that. I said, and I'm not saying this in derelict to any place, the shooting was in Texas. It's horrible. I'm not assigned to Texas. I'm assigned to Stafford or Freddysburg, if you know your assignment. I'm talking about knowing my assignment. So I said, God, but I know that you want us to have a heart. He says, yeah, my heart is that Stafford don't end up like Texas. That's why you got to teach. That's why you got to do this, because I want it to get in the hearts and minds of the people where I've assigned you, So now we can deal with this one area. That's why I say it don't have to look the same everywhere as long as God is doing the assignment. But then you get the call, well, what the church doing? We're over here doing what God assigned for us to do right here. Right. That don't mean we don't care.
It could have ever well been a grocery store here in Stafford. Yeah. It could have been somebody in our family. The point is, reality, we know it happened. How many of them hugged and embraced, or did they just know they're going shopping and come and expect to come back home? Or how many knew that you've been storing up weapons in my house?
Wow.
Again, it brings some understanding with, Lord, am I the priest of my house? Am I paying? And I'm not criticizing nobody else. It caused me to check myself. And we also got supporting scripture to deal with that. And I just want the congregation here, the church of Corinth, Apostle Paul wrote a letter back to the church, right? Mm-hmm. Amen. Y'all shake your head if you know that.
Yes.
Okay, there was confusion. There was chaos. They were deciding on who was the great preacher and all of that. Chaos. Before they can move forward, there has to be order.
Mm-hmm.
Guess who wrote a letter? Apostle Paul, to set some order. You with me?
Mm-hmm.
It was so much they were picking and choosing who were better, who was. They had lost sight. And that's in chapter 1. We know all of that. So now, you remember Cornelius had a dream, and he wanted to know what to do, and he was ordered to send and get Peter. Mm-hmm. So Peter can come and set some order. Remember Peter came, and I think that was in Acts chapter 10 or so.
Yes.
Peter came along and gave the order. But Peter also had a little still racism and bias in him.
Mm-hmm.
He liked how the Gentiles celebrated the Lord and worship, but when his friends came down from the Jews, he hopped over there. And then he hopped over here. Guess who had to set some order? Apostle Paul. He said, I had to call Peter out. He said, Peter, wake up, man. This is foolishness you're doing.
Right.
You know, you're sending the wrong message. It's talking about unity. How is it that we can enjoy and compel people to do stuff that we're not doing ourselves? Okay, watch this. Then they got a problem with circumcision, bringing about division. You have to be circumcised. The apostle James called an apostolic council together. All the apostles and many of the other elders, he called them to the rooms and had a meeting. And in that meeting, that's chapter 15 of Acts, you'll find out that James had the ability to call all the other apostles together. Not Peter, not Paul, not James, John. Mm-hmm. It was James, one that we very seldom hear of. And he sat in there and he listened, Pastor Tremaine, to the others. And then I believe it was Peter stood up and says, you know, these are the things that has happened. And then the other apostle put their two more in. And then James spoke up and said, it seems good to us and the Holy Spirit that we lay hands on you guys and let you do what God. We want order. That makes sense. So the purpose of bringing this title that I want us to begin to pay attention to the task, the assignment that you give, that God has given you. And maybe this is what Paul was talking about, desire the greatest gift.
Mm-hmm.
Look at what God is doing with you. Don't worry about the other. God got that. Okay? But we got to deprogram ourselves about trying to put people where we want them, deprogram ourselves about who doing what,
right.
And not seeking God in the direction he's given.
And one of the things as we prepare to close and we move and think about next week, it's our intent, if the Spirit says so, to walk through the fivefold callings, if you will, and show them all at work.
The tasking,
calling, the assignments, the tasking, to see them at work. Just like we walked through and saw the apostle at work, we want to walk through and see now that the order has been set, how God, you, the prophet, the evangelist, and the pastor, the teacher.
And Pastor Trimmer, it says so much when you just settle in. It just wrecks some of the stuff we've been taught. Remember, if the basic understanding of an apostle is to set order, it could be a little old lady that's so quiet in the church. You see the foolishness we do. She may just get up in the church and say, y'all need to stop that foolishness. That could be setting order. But because she don't have a collar on and she's not loud like me, We might overlook her because she's 90 years old. But God may be using her to set some order into place. Okay? The children shall lead them. God can use a child. Mm-hmm. Say, Mom and Dad, why y'all fighting? Y'all with what I'm saying?
Amen.
But because we are the adults and we think we know, we just kind of disregard maybe some great signs that God is doing among us because he's doing it, but I don't necessarily like that person. Last and then we're gonna pray. How many of you ever had somebody or known, or you may have done it yourself, somebody want to give marriage how to deal with your marriage, and they is all jacked up. How you need to raise your kid, and they don't have none. You know what I'm saying? I'm just trying to break it down in a basic way that we can understand. We try to shoulder titles and don't understand it. Every title you put on yourself comes with some responsibility. When you say that you're a doctor or something, that means you have studied, and you are an expert because you've done the research on it. But if you open your mouth, as Renee used to tell me, don't open your mouth and let people know for sure. It's best to be quiet. Y'all follow what I'm saying? So even I might find myself at times speaking on something that I have no knowledge about. Why? You know, so slow your roll, Lacey. Get in your lane. And if you're not tasked and signed, do that. So I just know now I'm just speaking it, and those who have ears to hear are supposed to receive it, and let's get this. So don't challenge me, because that's going to be a hard fight. So I'm not going to be speaking it if I don't believe God gave it.
Amen. And so remember that we talked about one of the ways that God speaks, and I pray that as we close in prayer, that in your private time you might begin to pray and ask God to reveal unto you what he is speaking, what he is trying to show us as the individual, the believer, the person, whoever we are, whatever assignment we have, whatever task we have, what he's allowing to happen and transpire in the world. I want to share this as I close in prayer because I think it's relevant. I personally, God showed me that to him it's not about the guns, it's about mental health. And so when it's about mental health, how does my task in an assignment, God say, how are you? I'm going to show you how to speak to this or deal with this in your assignment. So when we think about all of the tragedies and all of those things that happen, I pray that you lay before the Lord. Ask God, God, how does that work into this? Because we know if there's one thing that the body of Christ don't like to deal with is mental health. Right. So is God speaking to us as the kingdom, as the believers, as the task and an assignment that maybe we just need to check on one another, make sure everybody's all right, whatever the case may be, as we're moving through our God-given assignments and tasks. So, Father, we thank you for your anointing. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your giftings tonight, God, that have flowed without repentance. We thank you, God, that your spirit has descended upon us and gave a greater understanding into the taskings and assignments that you've equipped all of us to have in your giving. We're praying, God, now that as you begin to set order, not just in the church, but in the kingdom, in the world, in our homes, in our schools, in our communities, in the nation, that God, we will lend an ear to you to hear what you're speaking to us as an individual, that we might see, understand, and be about the assignment that you called us to be about. So God, tonight, it seems like it's so repetitive on our hearts, but God, we're laying again before you, God, another tragedy. More mothers, more fathers, more children, more loved ones, more aunts and uncles, people, God, that have been killed, people that have been affected by senseless violence. We pray, God, that you let us move out of ourselves, but we move out of you. We pray, God, that as we begin to pray, that we will pray and truly believe, God, that you will send healing, you will send support, you will send direction to your people, your assigned people, your call people, your task people, that wherever they are, God, they will hear your voice clearly and be about what you call them to be. And God, if it's so your will that we have an assignment to those places, that God, we do it of you and not of ourselves. So bless us, God, tonight and everything that we've heard, everything that we've said, that as we leave here, we will be better for the experience. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Have a blessed night in the Lord. So we have been allotting time. questions and comments.